This is the pilot episode, so have a little grace. Welcome to Sports and Stuff with Sam and Nicole. I'm Nicole.
I'm Sam. We'd just like to welcome everyone to our pilot episode.
Over a year, maybe, we've been talking about starting a podcast, Sam and I, and we're friends, longtime friends. We go way, way back. We'll get to that in a second. But we just kind of thought we talk weekly. We live in different states, and we just were, I was thinking one day, I was like, people should hear what we have to say.
Our conversations always go on for hours at a time sometimes, so I won't promise that our podcast will be that long, but I do promise the intriguing stuff will go into the podcast when we talk.
We went with the title Sports and Stuff with Sam and Nicole. It was kind of controversial because I was really stuck on this title, and I don't think Sam loves it, but we compromised and went with the title I wanted, and he got his name before mine.
And I feel like that's usually how relationships work when it's a guy and a girl working together. The guy just magically compromises to whatever it was supposed to be in the first place.
We both met at Disney World 2016, 4 years ago. Like,
DCP 2016.
DCP, Disney College Program, for anyone who is not familiar with the lingo.
Real quick, Nicole, let's have a moment of silence for the DCP real fast, because currently there is no CPers at Disney World. So,
yeah, it's actually really sad, Sam. Sam's being sarcastic right now.
I'll tell you right now, my life would not be the same if I did not do the CP. Let's rewind the clock to just slightly before the college program where Nicole and I's journey begins. From Colorado, grew up in Loveland, Colorado. I went to Colorado State University. I got a degree in business there. I was on the track team. Then I was an intramural manager. Anyone that repped a green shirt in college, you know what I mean. And then all of my friends were going abroad. They were going to Germany. I had a friend do the semester at sea, where you just literally live on a cruise ship for a semester. Everyone was going everywhere. And I was just like, what should I do to get away for a semester? And then I realized the Disney College program was a thing. I was like, Epcot's got like 18 countries. That's a pretty good abroad experience, right? So signed up for the college program, went down there, took a semester off. I recommend it to anybody that's currently in college or coming out of college, because you just always need a semester off to work and play. I didn't do any credits or anything, no school, all play. And I'll tell anyone right now, I partied way harder down at Disney than I ever did in college. And it's pretty ironic because Disney's a family company. And then that's when I met Nicole. We met walking around Epcot, and I couldn't pick her out of three people.
Do you want to tell them why you couldn't pick me out?
So the great thing about me meeting Nicole is I met a bunch of like our closest friends right now, including my girlfriend, who I'm still with. But my girlfriend, Nicole, and our other friend Ryan were all together, and they are legit all 5'4" and brunette. And me being 6'3", tough to tell when you're meeting new people.
When I met Sam, so yes, Disney College Program 2016, I was graduating from college, media and journalism major, wanted to get into sports reporting, always wanted to be like sideline at games, work for ESPN. I just went to University of South Dakota. I'm from South Dakota. And South Dakota doesn't always have the greatest sports opportunities. Shocker, there's no professional sports teams there. Disney owns ESPN. And I had heard of a couple of my friends had done the college program. And I was just like, I mean, what's really the worst thing that could happen? I go work for this huge company, take a semester off, not really a semester off, but trying to get put in for a transfer to go to ESPN. And after putting in my time at Disney, and I got a lot of flack from it, from professors, from I was also applying for news jobs, and I would have to go to like a small town market. So that's just kind of how media works, how TV journalism works. You have to like put in your time, go to all the small markets, and then you work your way up to the bigger markets, i.e. networks, ESPN, Fox Sports. Well, I didn't want to go to like my hometown and be a news reporter. So I was like, I'm just going to go to Disney World instead and put off the future for a little bit. Well, went there, loved it, put in a transfer, got to ESPN, worked at ESPN with the SEC Network in Charlotte. And then I, back in 2017, and then I've moved all around and now I'm in Lincoln, Nebraska covering the Huskers, which when we record this podcast, they are a winless football team. When this podcast goes live, I hope that's different.
The hilarious part with Nicole being in Lincoln now is being from Colorado, I grew up a CU Buffs fan. So also ironic, I went to CSU. But being a Buffs fan, CU and Nebraska has a long historic rivalry. So when Nicole told me she's going to go cover the Huskers, I was like, that sucks. They suck. They haven't been relevant since like 2002 to like actually be decent. And then like actually relevant, like winning championships since the 90s. So
it's actually really helpful for me because Sam helps kind of bring me down or brings me up, because right now I'm really down covering the Huskers right now because they're terrible. And it just really impacts your life. Like you hear about it in church homilies or preaches, doctor's offices, people are talking about like the Huskers, and everyone's mood is just kind of down because of the pandemic. It's really hard being in a small town that the food, the hand that feeds you is not doing well. And so I am either getting really invested or somehow I'm being really impacted, but Sam does a really good job of, I'll call him and I'll just be like, well, first of all, during the Colorado, Nebraska game last year, Nebraska was up 17-0 at half and then they lost, terrible second half. Sam calls me, like, I'm at work. I don't think he understood this at the time, but he just calls me. I'm trying to cut highlights, put in stats, get our show done. And I didn't even answer it because I was like, I don't have time for this. And I get this long voicemail. And the only thing he says is, Nicole, Scott Frost sucks. They shouldn't have gone to the kicker. Like, Colorado's amazing. I was like, I don't have time for this. I cover Nebraska. It's a laughingstock to a lot of my friends. But I don't have time for them bull crapping with me when I'm working.
I was also at a birthday bash in Nashville that weekend and we were watching it at a bar and, you know, one to two go to the head. And I'm like, you know, it's a great idea to call Nicole about this Husker. She covers the Huskers closer than anybody I know. Need to
be nothing right now. Let's call.
She's probably doing nothing right now. Let's break down the game, you know, a little Sam Nicole style, talk about that kicker choking and stuff. That's what I thought needed to happen at that time.
Sam and I would talk every Thursday, just catch up, see how each other's doing. And now we are moving that to Tuesdays. And now it's going to be recorded for all six of you listeners, which are probably our friends. Sports talk with Sam and Nicole. Sports going on right now. College football, NFL, NBA potentially coming back sooner than later. And Masters this week, which I don't really like golf, so I'm not really going to be paying attention. NBA coming back. Sam, do the Nuggets have it?
So I think the Nuggets made great progress in the bubble. They did way better than I thought they were going to do. I counted them out when they were down 3-1 against the Jazz. I was like, all right, we took a step backwards after beating the Western Semis last year. Come storming back from 3-1. And then I doubly counted them out when they were 3-1 against the Clippers, because national media, all they did was like, Clippers or Lakers, Clippers or Lakers, Clippers or Lakers. And I'm like, well, that's not the Nuggets, and they don't look good. The Nuggets are the most streaky team ever. They're either hot or they're not, and that's what happened in that series. And then they come roaring back, which is extremely exciting. The Nuggets haven't been in the Western Conference Finals in 11 years. And then they get smacked by LeBron, which I'm fine with. LeBron is the best player in the world, and he was on a mission. So I'm cool with where the Nuggets ended up. I think Michael Porter Jr. came out a lot, which is what the Nuggets needed, because that's the difference between them being a middle-of-the-pack Western Conference team and a elite Western Conference team. So him coming out was great news for the Nuggets. And then we'll see what it is. I predict they will be top four Western Conference teams going into the playoffs next year.
There you go. Well, I don't have too much to give on standings of playoffs at the Western Conference Finals, but we are going to talk about the NBA might be starting in January.
I think they're going to come out before Christmas. I think December 22nd is the timeline they just agreed on. Several of the basketball teams have not played since March. They've been sitting around for 9 months waiting for something to do. What's Steph Curry been doing for 9 months? His golf game's pretty good right now. Like everyone just focuses on LeBron having a 72-day off season. How's LeBron going to do it? I'm like, a lot of the teams haven't really been doing too much since the bubble, you know? So let them play. LeBron can rest up anyway. LeBron doesn't need to play until March anyway. Let him rest.
Yeah, he said he was going to be cherry picking the entire season. That's why he got Anthony Davis.
And other huge news in college football, Notre Dame pulls off the upset of number one Clemson at home.
But what they did afterwards was a lot worse than what they did on the field.
For those of you that don't know us, and I'm assuming we've gained at least 6 viewers since we started this. So for the 6 of you that don't know us, one of my good friends, Joe, went to Notre Dame. And starting our sophomore year of college, we started going to Notre Dame games every year. So it's a tradition at this point. We go to a Notre Dame football game every year, tailgate the crap out of it, just have good old times. And if you have not been to Notre Dame Stadium to beat a football game, you're doing yourself a disservice because it is one of the coolest places to watch a football game in America. The game we were supposed to go to this year was Notre Dame Clemson, but you know, with COVID, they only allow students and staff. So sad not at the game. Super big win for Notre Dame though to pull off the game, despite Trevor Lawrence being out for COVID.
Who was on the sideline.
All right. So yeah, that was the other very confusing part for me. I'm like, all right, so you have COVID and can't play, but you're at the game. So why aren't you playing? Or like, if you don't have COVID, like if you have COVID, like be at home, or don't have COVID and play, like what's going on here? I was so confused. As long as Notre Dame doesn't lose by more than 14 points, I'm going to say they will be in the playoff again this year.
I also do not have much to give to the college football playoff, besides the fact that maybe they could increase it to 6 and potentially even 8 during this year, because this year is crazy. And I just think it's ridiculous that the NFL is letting half of the teams make the playoffs, literally like the Cowboys, the NFC East. No one can figure that out. And that the winner of the NFC East is going to make the playoffs, and yet in college football, with 300,000 million teams playing, 4 people make the playoff. It makes no sense to me.
Yeah, I keep up with the Nebraska team more than I ever would have before. I started following like the Go Big Red like account and like all the tweets and stuff. So if Nicole tells me there's some controversy in Lincoln, at least I'm aware of what's going on. Or like if they try to like secretly like date University of Chattanooga, I'm aware of like they're trying to like go behind the Big Ten's back, which like Nebraska just needs to like settle down, accept where you're at. You've been in the Big Ten for 10 years now. You make a lot more money being in the Big Ten than being in the Big 12 where you were at. You're facing much better competition, in my opinion. I think Big Ten up and down is a superior conference than the Big 12, no doubt. I mean, the SEC is the only better conference in America. But it all comes down to money, and you're making a ton of money. So just sit down, shut up, play the games that they schedule you. And guess what? Memorial Stadium is going to be full every Saturday as soon as they start letting fans back in.
Disney talk, Disney World, looking like it, well, okay. We should maybe look up COVID numbers when we do this, maybe not, I don't know. In Lincoln right now, and in Nebraska, they're rising right now. I don't know how it is in Florida.
Colorado's seeing a huge spike right now. We're posting our highest numbers of the entire pandemic right now. Like over the weekend, we posted a day that had 3,900 new cases. Disneyland is still closed. And it will not be opening for the foreseeable future because California is on a colored grid system, and any public space or anything like that, which that Disney would fall in that category, the actual county itself has to hold like 2 or 3 weeks at a certain, at the lowest color, which is like yellow or something. I don't know. We could look it up. But Orange County, California is in like one of the hot spots in California, which has had consistently very high cases for the last ever. So Disneyland not looking like it's going to open soon. Florida, however, still going strong as far as I know, just the capacities are much lower and Disney has put in a lot of their own guidelines and restrictions and stuff like that just to ensure safety for anyone. And like on the record, like if I were to trust any company to like get safe COVID protocols anywhere, it would be Disney.
Yeah, they definitely, I wish everyone could work at Disney for like a semester or a couple months and just go through their training program and just be a part of like customer or guest engagement. Like guest relations is so high there. One of the greatest skills ever is having to be happy or treating someone happy when they're mad at you or like screaming or inconvenienced. And you're just like, it's okay. We're going to remain calm. Like people will scream at, like I remember this lady was so upset when I was at Disney. I worked in merchandise in the Magic Kingdom, which is the busiest park of them all. And she's like freaking out because she wants to get this new Magic Band, this deluxe Magic Band, because the Magic Band she got from her resort isn't the cool big deluxe one. And then so, and of course they want it like set up right then and there to like link everything that they have. And then she's like, well, we have a Pirates of the Caribbean fast pass in 20 minutes. And I'm like, why are you in Fantasyland when you need to be in Adventureland? But I can't say that. So I'm just like, it's okay. Like, we'll get you set up. And you just tell them that like, we'll phone over there and say you're on your way. And then they have like a 10 minute grace period anyways. But it's just like,
I think one thing to duly note is people severely underrate the scale of Disney World by a lot. I know people who like, they'll be like, oh, we've gone to Disneyland a bunch of times. We know what it is. And like Disneyland, if you know what you're doing, you can get everything done in a day. If you're really kind of lost, 2 to 3 days. Disney World is so much larger than that. I would book a week straight if you have not been there or don't know what you're doing. You need a week to do it all. And especially if you don't know how to like work the fast passes or work the My Disney Experience app or like book reservations. Like I have no idea what it's been like since COVID because I haven't been there in literally a year now. I was down there for the Wine and Dine half marathon last year at this time. But it's crowded always. The capacities there are crazy. Disney can employ 70,000 people in Florida for a reason. So I have a list that I've already created that I was going to post on my personal Instagram. I'm creating a legit top 16 bracket of the top Disney soundtracks. And then you know how I do polls on my Instagram, just every day will be a new head-to-head matchup and then they'll slowly progress. So we can preview that list here if you want.
Hit me with which one you want.
All right. So let's go ahead and let's go top five as our segment today. Let's preview my top 16 Disney soundtrack list, and you can tell me what you think. So I'm only gonna give you the top five seeds though. So this is picture March Madness. This is the West region, top five seeds. We'll see who comes out of here to make a Final Four appearance.
Okay.
All right, so number one, or let's count it backwards. Number five Disney soundtrack of all time, in my opinion, Hercules.
That's a good one.
Number four.
Is this yourself?
This is all my personal opinion. It's all my personal opinion.
I'm supposed to not know the top ones. I'm supposed to know the top ones in your brain.
This is all personal opinion. Yep. This is based on whatever scale I thought of in my head when I watched this movie or listened to this soundtrack 4,000 times. This is what's going to make my top five.
Okay. This is not subjective or objective at all.
This is very subjective opinion.
Hercules, so, 5, 4.
Hercules, coming in at 5, 4, Lion King.
Oh, man.
Number 3, The First Frozen. The First Frozen, soundtrack-wise, has gone multi-platinum. So.
Okay. You said Moana for 2. Don't tell Moana. Me one. I want to guess one.
All right, Nicole, try and guess the number one soundtrack, in my opinion, of
in
Disney.
In your brain, the number one Disney soundtrack of all time. And we've already hit Lion King, Hercules, Frozen, and Moana.
Correct.
Is it your favorite Disney movie?
It's not my favorite movie, but it does have the best soundtrack.
Is it old Disney, new Disney?
It's modern Disney. So picture 90s Disney. So not like Walt Disney Disney, but like.
There are multiple of them.
Yeah.
I have a guess, but I don't really know the music. And is it Pixar?
No.
Okay. That takes out my guess. I wanted to say Toy Story, but I don't think it's that because that's Pixar.
That is my favorite Disney movie.
I know. That's why I was like, it's not very good music.
Don't knock Randy Newman now. All right. He gets some good background music. All right.
Hot take, Nicole doesn't like Pixar. I know your iTunes account, so I'm trying to think of like what songs you have. Tarzan?
Tarzan is my number one Disney soundtrack.
You're joking.
It is Tarzan, number one. You can't beat Phil Collins in that soundtrack, bar none. I am a
genius. I know what's in your brain.
You are. That's good. Cue Son of Man. Get it queued up here. Let's listen to some Son of Man.
I guessed your top soundtrack in your brain.
That's impressive because, again, completely subjective to my own opinion.
Wow.
Great pick, Nicole. Congrats on the well-executed pick. You should go to Vegas right now.
Well, everyone, all 6 of you, thanks for listening. This has been a great season 1, episode 1, pilot episode of Sports and Stuff with
Sam
and Nicole, and you guys can follow along. We don't know when the next episode's going to be, but I think this is fun. This was fun.
I still don't know what to do with my hands, but.
Well, you can follow along. I will be posting this on my YouTube channel, Nicole Griffith, NicoleGriffith. You can follow us on Insta. They're below, or else it's Nicole_Griffith_ or Sam with his amazing sizzle Sammy B. For Nicole and Sam and Phil.
Signing off.